Welcome to EPG Parshala for a discussion on syllable and syllabification in OT. The objective of this module is to familiarize you with the value of a syllable structure. The objective of this module is to familiarize you with the essential properties of a syllable as a unit of metrical structure. It also introduces discussion on how pre-OT structural terminologies have got converted into OT constraints. Finally, the functional usefulness of syllable has and how it works in formulating the OT accounts of various phonological processes have also been discussed here. Introducing the value of syllable in phonological theory, particularly in optimality mechanism, René Kagar, 99, writes, "The syllable is a major ingredient of phonological generalizations. It is crucial in defining phonodactic patterns, well-formed sequences of segments, consonants and vowels. The syllable also governs patterns of epenthesis and deletion. It supplies a level of prosodic organization between segments and higher level prosodic units. Finally, syllable functions in the demarcation of morpheme edges and in defining the position and shape of affixes." The question arises then, what is the place of a syllable in prosodic hierarchy? What is a prosodic hierarchy? A prosodic hierarchy is a hierarchical ordering of prosodic categories from the lowest to the highest. It is shown here as left to right order from the lowest to the highest in the picture. At the lowest or the leftmost are the segments CV, and above it are syllables, and above syllable metrical foot, and metrical foot above that is phonological word, and above that phonological phrases, and above that is intonational phrases, and above is utterance. So this is the prosodic hierarchy where we can locate syllable. What is the internal structure of a syllable? The internal structure of a syllable can be shown in a linear order as onset, nucleus and coda. Onset can have number of consonants theoretically, though practically not possible. That's why C, N and V are the nucleus, and then C, N again within bracket, implying that theoretically any number of consonants can be there in the coda also. But as we know that within a syllable, the number of consonants cannot be increased unnecessarily and impracticably. Then how do the distribution take place within the syllable? This distribution takes place according to SSP, sonority sequencing principle. SSP is one of the universal syllabification principles. It says segments rank highest on sonority scale at the center, that is nucleus within a syllable. So, the nucleus of a syllable, that is the vowel, is the peak and it occupies the central position within a syllable, and on its two sides, that is on the margins, are located the consonants. From the peak, the movement is downwards on both sides, that is, they increase lower, they increasingly lower as they move to the edges of the syllable, that is, to the onsets and codas of the syllable. What is sonority scale and its structure? Vowels and consonants universally are distributed in a scale of lowest sonority to highest sonority. This scale is called sonority scale. The picture here shows the sonority scale. At the lowest level are the complex plosives, and at the highest, low open vowels. Now, all other vowels and consonants exist in between. At the upper edge are the vowels, low, mid, and high vowels, and thereafter comes all the consonants, flap, laterals, nasals, voice fricatives, voiceless fricatives, voiced plosives, voiceless plosives, complex plosives. For example, in a word like big, there is only one syllable and it has the structure CVC. The first C is a voiced plosive and the last C or the coda consonant is also a voiced plosive, and in between is the peak or the nucleus, which is E. So this follows SSP. When there are clusters in the margins, then also we see SSP is obeyed. For example, in the word blind, B is lowest and above that is the lateral L, and then rising continues up to the peak E, and then the sonority decreases towards the right and it comes down to the nasal N, and then finally ends with the voiced plosive D. By and large, languages follow SSP, but there are also counter evidence to this. For example, in English, we have words like sticks, words like school, words like spring, strike, where the SSP is violated because so is high in sonority, followed by very low, pa, ta, etc. And then suddenly there is a jump towards the peak in the nucleus. This issue will be taken up very shortly in this module. The second universal principle of syllabification is maximal onset principle. This is the other major universal principle involved in the syllabification process. Across languages, consonants syllabify maximally as the onset of a syllable unless prevented by language-specific phonetic constraints. This is particularly concerned with the syllabification of intervocalic consonants, as in VCV goes to V and CV, not VC and V. The picture shows the syllabification of English word lady as CV, CV. Kokborok word any, ani, a and ni. Meitei word ima, I, ma, and Tripura Bangla word uli, u, and li. But There are also words where the intervocalic consonants do not uniformly get divided into two syllables in the coda of the previous syllable and onset of the following syllable, as in the word afraid, admire, in admire, da is the coda of the previous syllable and ma goes to the onset of the following syllable. But in afraid, fa and ra go to the onset of the following syllable and constitute a cluster. When there are three consonants within two vowels, the similar process continues, as in impress, where ma goes to the coda of the previous syllable and paro goes to the onset of the following syllable. But one thing is to be noted, that there is no violation of SSP, however, here. OT captures syllable structure and syllabification through constraints. Now, what are the OT constraints for syllabification and syllable structure? They are part syllable, that is, every syllable belongs to a foot, SSP, sonority increases towards the syllable peak and decreases towards the syllable margin, onset, that is, syllables must have onset, and no coda, syllables are open or syllable does not have coda consonant. Now, let us have a look at the OT mechanism or OT grammar with these constraints. The three constraints, parse syllable, onset and no coda, are here uniformly ranked as undominated. They are not mutually ranked. They are all undominated. When this is the ranking of the constraints, the result will be a CV, whatever be the input. For example, out of do, do will only survive because it violates no constraint, but O violates onset, odd violates onset, and dot violates no coda. All three constraints are undominated and equally important. Hence, any violation of any of the constraints incurs fatal violation for the candidate A, C, and D. CV, therefore, is the winner. With this constraint ranking, we can illustrate the concept of freedom of analysis. What is freedom of analysis? Any amount of structure may be posited as input for an optimal output. So, because in OT, there is no restriction on selection of the input for any output. So, any amount of structure may be posited as input for an optimal output. With this grammar, that is, parse, syllable, onset, and coda, whatever be the input posited, the output of the constraint ranking will be CV or DO, as shown in this figure. DO maps to DO, odd also maps to DO, O also maps to DO, DOT dot also maps to DO. So output is DO. Inputs are different, but output is same. The optimal one, CV. It is a beauty of optimality theory. An important premise of OT is lexicon optimization. It says, in the absence of any surface evidence to the contrary, input is posited as closest to the structure of the output. In other words, for positing any input for an output, it is better to go for an input which is closest to the output. In other words, input-output matching is preferred. Now, why this is so? Contrary to freedom of analysis, which allows selection of any input for an output, lexicon optimization stipulates that the input may be posited as closer to output when there is no evidence to the contrary, because in terms of constraint violation, this strategy has the advantage of minimizing the violation of faithfulness as compared to any other hypothetical inputs producing the same output. So there is a kind of argument here in favor of matching the input and output as much as possible. In other words, the input elements should be retained in the output, but across languages, there is a preference for deleting the coda. Now, if lexicon optimization insists that there is the coda consonant should be retained, then it will go against the preference noted across languages. Now, if CVC is to be mapped to CVC, that is, if the input coda is to be retained in the output, a correspondence constraint is needed, namely max IO. Max IO simply states that no deletion of the input elements in the output. So, on the other hand, max IO is for no deletion, but no coda will be insisting on deleting a coda. So, there is a direct conflict between these two constraints. To resolve this crisis, the optimality theoretic dispensation will be to rank these two constraints, that is, max IO will dominate no coda. Now, no coda will be there, but as a lower ranked constraint, because coda will have to be there in the output. So, that is what we see, that with the input CVC, V is ruled out because it lacks onset and it deletes two consonants and thereby violates max IO twice. CV violates max IO fatally once, and VC violates onset fatally once. So, CVC is the winner. But if we are going ahead with this ranking, there will be a problem. This is likely to legitimize the insertion of any new codas or onset for no reason. Now, let us remember that any uncalled for expansion by insertion is ruled out by anti-insertion constraint DIP IO. This also helps in avoiding clusters in the present case, both in onset and coda. A consonant can be inserted if it is necessary for filling up the position of an onset, but for filling up the position of the coda, insertion of a consonant is never encouraged. Again, for creating marginal clusters, neither insertion, that is for coda or for onset, is preferred. So, this is shown by the by the non-selection of the two candidates E and F. Both of them violate DEEP IO once and twice successively. So, this is how this lexicon optimization as well as freedom of analysis can be compromised. Now, despite the previous negation of complex margins, there are complex margins in English, as you have already noted. This is because of domination of faithfulness over markedness. Faithfulness along with SSP dominates markedness, and the result is the surfacing of underlying clusters as in train. In this picture we see faith, which stands for all, stands for both no deletion and no insertion, that is the faithfulness constraints, along with SSP undominated, and both anti-cluster constraints star onset CC and star coda CC are dominated, and the result is that train is selected as the optimal candidate. It is true for other UR coda clusters too, UR or underlying coda clusters too, as in BOLD, B-O-L-D, here LERDA is underlyingly there or in the input, and it surfaces despite the violation of the anti-coda cluster constraint ranked lowest. Okay, in the next picture, BODL violates, B-O-D-L violates SSP, BOD and BOL violates faith. Therefore, both are ruled out. Underlying onset and coda clusters along with no violation of SSP. Let us have a look at the evaluation of the output for the word brand. Brand is the input and the output is also brand. Now, here there are clusters on both sides of the vowel or the nucleus. Bra, this is, does not violate SSP, and Nada also does not violate SSP. Only the two anti-cluster constraints are violated, but they being markedness constraints dominated by faithfulness constraints and SSP, the winner is brand and it is not disturbed. So, but if there is any metathesis, something like raba or dana, then SSP is violated in addition to other violations, and therefore they are ruled, B and C are ruled out. Da, that is candidate D, E, F and G are ruled out because of deletion of some underlying item. Now, with regard to the structures of syllables like sata, sapa or sa in English. There is obviously a new constraint is required. Now, what is that constraint? A logical expectation now crops up. English language has monosyllables like sting, skull, spin, etc., with sa as the first consonant. As per the prosodic scale given earlier, sa is higher in sonority than the following consonant ta, ka, pa, all voiceless plosives. Obviously, there is a sonority decline in the second consonant compared to the first, and immediately before the sonority peak, that is the vowel, SSP is severely violated. To provide a principled account to such apparent deviation from the SSP, we refer to a markedness constraint that militates against reversal of sonority in the rising towards the syllable peak. This is a specific constraint under SSP. What is the constraint is called star reversal. Sonority reversals are disallowed, as in star syllable S, C, voice, minus voice and minus continuant. This is proposed by Morelli in ROA 2, 420. This markedness constraint is ranked below faith but above SSP. The general markedness constraint SSP is defined by reversal, and hence the latter must dominate the former. Another constraint, linearity IO, a correspondence constraint objecting against metathesis of input segment in the output as a repair strategy to satisfy SSP, is also invoked, and it is ranked amongst the undominated constraints. Anti-cluster constraints like star CC occupies the lowest position as inevitably violated. So linearity IO is another constraint which has to be included in this grammar. Linearity IO says that the output reflects the precedence structure of the input and vice versa. Kagar 99, based on Peter 96. The proposed hierarchy, therefore, is, as is shown, faith, linearity IO, dominate, reversal, dominate SSP, dominates CC, star CC at the onset. And the result of this ranking is the successful selection of a so-called deviant structure like sting, where the input is sting and the selected output is also sting, and as this tableau shows, and sting violates reversal, but reversal being a low ranked constraint, this is a well-formedness constraint and it is ranked low, that's why its violation does not hamper the winning of the underlying input or the structure as the surface structure. And SSP is also now ranked low, but it also does not hamper the selection of the optimal output sting. CC is necessarily violated because, and in the onset, there is a cluster sha ta. Ta sa violates linearity, that is because of it is it includes the metathesis of between sa ta goes to ta sa. Sing and ding both under have deletion of some underlying items, that's why both are ruled out. The same grammar as this one also holds for structures or clusters having three consonants, as in sapara, satara, sakara, etc., or s plus vowel stress obstruent plus glide or liquid. Here the two first consonants sapa, sata, and saka, they are the so called deviant structures, but they are successfully dealt with by this proposed hierarchy presented here. And presence of raw or the liquid is not anti-SSP because it follows the sonority rising trend. We have also demonstrated how the grammar requires a new constraint and how it is to be argued for and how it has to be invoked. Now, it is all these have been demonstrated with the help of words and their evaluation mechanisms taken from English.